Hi, I record these videos a bit before I actually post them, but this video should be coming out right before Christmas. And so I want to start today by talking about two stories that I have from my own life. The first story is from the very first year that I was a pastor. You see, one of the things I got to do that year that I had never done before was lead a worship service on Christmas Eve. And so you have the 4 weeks of Advent kind of building up to that, where you kind of rehearse, you oftentimes at least will rehearse a large part of the story leading up to the birth of Jesus. And then you finally get to that moment of Christmas Eve, and you talk about the importance of God coming to be with us in and as the man Jesus. And one of the things I said at that particular time is I said that Christmas is only of relative importance. I said Christmas is important, but it's only relatively important, because I said the reason why we care about Christmas is not because of what anything Christmas is in itself, but because it leads us to Easter. At the time when I said that, I absolutely meant it, and I really wanted people to always remember the fact that whenever they see the cradle of Jesus, whenever they see that manger in the nativity scene, they should imagine the shadow of a cross going over it, because the important thing, as I was trying to say, was that God had to become a human being in order to provide that perfect sacrifice, so that down the road, several years, he would be able to die and provide a perfect sacrifice in atonement for us. Well, let's fast forward about 9 months, because I served as a pastor for a full year before I began seminary. I attended seminary at the University of Dubuque Theological Seminary in Dubuque, Iowa. And so I live in Iowa, and that was part of the reason why, is that I would be able to serve a church in my home annual conference without having to travel too far. I could drive to school and back and still be able to serve at least part-time. And so there was part of the interest in it. But I'd also applied to some other schools as well. But what got me to really commit to University of Dubuque, among other things, was because of one particular professor there named Elmer Collier. And he still teaches there. He's leading the United Methodist Studies program. And I got to be his research assistant for a couple of years. But the exciting thing for me when I went there was he has this amazing reputation among the United Methodists in Iowa, that he is a clear teacher and he challenges his students, and so many people grow and have such positive experiences. I thought I really need to make sure I go and study with this man. And in fact, one person on one of the boards I met with said, you know, Travis, I'd like you to go to whatever school they had gone to. But at the same time, if you want to learn John Wesley, there's no one better to learn from, perhaps, than Elmer Collier. So I went. The way the seminary had its rules was that if you were working at least half time, you could only have so many credits any given semester. They didn't want you to work so hard you drove yourself crazy and burned yourself out. So the first semester, I had an extra 3 credits that I could either fill with a class or not. And so I asked my advisor what I should do. And he said, tell you what, Travis, you could take this 3-quarter class on United Methodist history. Sign up for it. Take a week or two of it. See if you're up for it. Well, I show up to this class, and it's a 3-hour class from 3 till 6 p.m., and it's all about John Wesley and the early Methodists and Methodist history. And I had such a profound experience in that first 3-hour class that the moment it was over, I stepped out of the building, I called my wife on the phone, and I said, I will do anything it takes to remain in this class. It was a powerful experience. One of the things that I was confronted with very early on in this class is that, according to Dr. Collier, and I've come to agree with him, part of what made the early Methodist movement so dynamic, so effective, was because it was formed and shaped by a deep Trinitarian conviction. That, in fact, the whole pattern of every Christian's life was seen as outworking this fact that this triune God has come to be with us and has come to shape us. Now, here's the thing, though. When I went to seminary in the first place, if you had asked me about the Trinity, I would have said, you know, I think I probably understand it about as well as anybody else's. You know, the three are one, the one is three. Nobody really understands it, so we just kind of go along with it. Well, I started having to come to terms with the fact that according to this professor of mine, whom I respected and was clearly very knowledgeable, I had to come to terms with the fact that this doctrine of the Trinity was far more important to Christian faith than I had ever in my life considered. And over the course of that first year, I kind of was working through it, and I came to be convinced of it, even though I couldn't unpack it fully at the time. Well, anyway, over that summer, I found I was processing still the things I had learned over the previous year. And I had said to my wife, I missed this important belief in Christian faith. I missed the centrality of the Trinity. And so I wonder if there's anything else that I've missed and just haven't noticed. So I told her what I want to do is try to be thinking through and find out what really is the very most core central belief in all of Christian faith. So anyway, I tell her this, and then weeks later, we happen to be driving home from somewhere, and I have a flash of insight, like you sometimes have. And I said, I was driving, so I kept my hands on the wheel and my eyes on the road, but I said, I've got it. And my wife said, got what? And I said, I know what the most important doctrine of Christian faith is. And she knew I was thinking about it, so she said, okay, so what is it? And I said, you know, with a perfectly serious face, no question I might be saying anything unusual, I said, the incarnation. And I could just feel her in the passenger seat just staring at me. And she finally opened her mouth and said, really, Travis? Jesus is the most important part of Christianity. Gosh, you know, I never saw that one coming. But my point is that what I realized in a deeper and more robust way than I ever had before is that this fact that God took on human flesh and lived among us is the core of everything. In fact, part of what pushed me to that point was when I realized that we wouldn't have a doctrine of the Trinity if we didn't have an incarnation, if one of those persons of the Trinity hadn't come among us and taken on our flesh and revealed to us that there is this distinction of persons. So why am I sharing this with you? Well, partly because Christmas is right around the corner and the incarnation, the coming of God to be with us, really is the central point of Christmas. But also because what I've discovered is that this basic fact that any, you know, fourth grade Sunday school student could tell me that Jesus is the reason that we have Christianity, what I found is that it's not always fully appreciated and people don't really internalize that in a way that seems to me to be demanded by this belief in the centrality of Jesus. And this really was played out to me at one point because when I went over to St. Andrews to work on a PhD, my supervisor's son was there and I told him this story about coming to the conclusion that the incarnation was the most important doctrine of Christian faith. And he looked at me and said, you know, Travis, I agree with you, but I'm surprised that you didn't come up with saying the crucifixion of Jesus is the most important because a lot of folks here, he said, would say that. What struck me in that moment is that many well-intentioned Christians will say to you that the thing that really matters, the basic belief of Christian faith, is that Jesus died for you. Not even necessarily the resurrection, the crucifixion, the atoning death is the center. And at the time I thought to myself, well, I mean, I guess that could still be important, but if you're going to have that, if you're going to have a crucifixion, you need to have Christmas in order to have Easter. And all of a sudden I realized that that thing I did on that first year I was a pastor, I said exactly that same thing. I said that the only reason really why we care about Christmas is because it leads to Easter. And you can't have an Easter without a Christmas. Later on, I preached a sermon that essentially was apologizing for that to say, I will never again say that Christmas is even relatively unimportant. Aside from all that, it's a little bit of a running joke with people who know me that I tend to try to restructure any kind of conversation we may be having, any kind of debate about what we believe. And I always try to reframe it in terms of what does the incarnation tell us about this? What does the fact that God became a human being in and as Jesus of Nazareth tell us about these things? You know, for example, I've mentioned in a previous video that if we're told this is what God's like and we look at Jesus and we don't see that there, in fact, we may see the very opposite of it. We have to take what we actually see and actually encounter in Jesus as the more fundamental belief. But in any case, today what I want to do is I want to highlight a couple of things of what that means. So the centrality of Jesus is that Jesus is God in flesh. That means that when we hear the words of Jesus, the words of this human man who is also the very being of God, when we hear those words from Jesus, they are both at the very same time human words that we can hear and understand and experience and process. And at the same time, they are also the words of God, the very teachings of God. They're not even words that are filtered through some kind of mediator. It's not like you can have a prophet and say, well, this prophet says this and that prophet says that and try to find some creative tension between them. No, this is the God of the universe saying this in human words. We either take it or we leave it and we can't really have a middle ground. It also means that when we see the actions of Jesus, they are, on the one hand, they are very human actions. A real human being is doing these actions. They're the same kinds of actions in a way that we can do and that other people can do. But at the very same time, the things we see Jesus do in the Gospels is at the same time the very acts of God. So when Jesus comes and touches someone, it's not just a human person touching them. It is God touching them. When Jesus comes and forgives somebody, it's not just a human act of forgiveness. It is a divine act of forgiveness. That everything that Jesus does is at the very same time, both a human thing that we can see and experience and understand, and at the same time, the very act, word of God. The fact that God came to live among us in and as the man Jesus of Nazareth also means that God can show us what to do and show us how to be. That it's not simply a matter of saying words to us and delivering a message to us. God can actually demonstrate to one degree or another how we're supposed to live. And sometimes he can give a teaching that may seem to be overwhelming. Like I remember reading about, you know, parish people have said that when Jesus says, you know, when one person strikes you, you should turn the other cheek to them as well. And this ethic of the New Testament, and specifically the ethic of the Sermon on the Mount. And they make it an argument at one point saying, you know, Jesus can't really be taken seriously because you can't live this way. Nobody can live this way. Well, Jesus lived that way. Now, it might be that living that way consistently over time could get you killed, in which case maybe you can't live that way. But that doesn't seem to be a problem for Jesus. He seems to be able to do that just as well. And he doesn't seem to be hindered by the fact that it might bring about his death, and indeed it does. Imagine if God had not come to be with us, if God had simply been content to send prophet and messengers after us, then at no point could any one of them say in the same way that Jesus does, come follow me. I mean, they might be able to send a message, they might be able to send something like that, some guidance, but at no point could a prophet, a mere human representative, say something like, come follow me, and have that be anything like what it means to follow God. So, as you move closer and closer to Christmas this year, and then farther and farther into your life away from this particular Christmas, I would encourage you to not let the shadow of the cross obliterate the importance of the cradle. Don't allow Easter to push Christmas out of its place. It is true that we could never have had Easter if we didn't have Christmas, but there's a lot of other things that we couldn't have had without Christmas as well. And in fact, so many things are so valuable about hearing the word of God and seeing the actions of God are absolutely irreplaceable and cannot be simply reduced to an instrumental creation of a perfect human being to be the perfect sacrifice. So when Christmas comes and you celebrate by singing songs, or you celebrate even by opening presents, by gathering with family, by worshiping on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, I encourage you, remember, this is the central, beautiful fact and mystery of the gospel. That God took on human flesh and dwelt among us, and we were able to behold his glory in a human being and as a human being, just like one of us. Well, that's it for this week. If you have any questions or if you have any topics you'd like me to take up and get my two cents on, please send me an email at pastorstevic@gmail.com. I'll look forward to hearing from you, and I'll see you next time.